All right.
We're good to go.
We're good to go.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, thank you everyone for joining us. Today we're going to be talking about Panopto videos and Canvas. We're going to cover a lot today. But of course you can always reach out to us. Carrie will be sending out some resources after, so you don't need to worry too much about taking notes or writing down links or anything like that. The whole ed tech team is here today to talk through some pieces. We don't usually get to come to these in the same capacity. I think, you know, I know a lot of you, not all of you, and all of you know some of us, I think, but me, obviously, and then we have Suzanne, Garrett, and Nick, and, you know, you can always reach us at our website or at our email address. So I think I'm going to hand it off to Carrie, and she can talk to us a little bit about some basics of when to record.
Thank you, Teresa. So why we sort of timed doing a Panopto session at this point pre-semester is because we can anticipate a few of these items happening that would prompt us to want to record our session. So one is that it's quite likely that we will have student absences, right? There's my roommate got COVID, I tested positive, I was exposed. All of these reasons might contribute to students not being there in the classroom with you. And what you might find, rather than repeating yourself in office hours over and over again, is that recording is the right choice for you. As of right now, there's no mandate to record, so this is you making that decision, but student absences is probably going to contribute to that. And then if you are just trying to record, refresh your video content, kind of aggregate what you've recorded in the last few semesters, when you prioritize what's worth capturing on video, the evergreen and core topics of your course are going to be the ones worth capturing. Evergreen meaning it's not going to change because the market changed, it's not going to change because you know, these policies are constantly shifting. It's something, some sort of principle that stays the same, which isn't a ton of things, but you might be able to say, okay, in the next 5 years, I don't see this changing. And then the last reason you really might want to record is any sort of technical step-by-step tutorial. So if you're showing them how to use a software like Tableau or Excel, recording or making a short video might be your best bet. And it will keep you from having to repeat those things too often. And it's the kind of thing that your students will want to scrub through, repeat, go back, follow along with. So having it recorded is your friend. If you are teaching any sessions of your course online, be it that we end up coming to campus a couple weeks late, or we just want to have a couple of asynchronous sessions or synchronous Zoom sessions in your course, you cannot require your students to turn on their cameras. You can give an appeal saying, hey, I really have an easier time teaching you when I can see you, and it really helps my instruction. I think it helps your learning. You can give that sort of appeal, but you can't compel or require them to turn their cameras on. You also need to announce that you're recording, like I did at the beginning of the session today. Students may join late, but as long as you announce it at the beginning, you've sort of covered your bases. And the easiest way to remember to do that is to put it on the slide. It was on the first slide for us today. Otherwise, you'll certainly forget, as I often can. Explain to your students why you're recording. It's kind of common when you start recording your sessions that you see a bit of a drop off in participation. It can feel a little bit different to participate in discussions when you know that there's a record being kept. But if you explain, hey, a third of your classmates are out every other week because of these absences, I really need to record for their sake, they might understand a little bit about what's going on and why it's being saved for posterity. And describe any steps that you're taking toward privacy with your recording. So we'll talk a lot about Panopto today, and you'll be really well versed in being able to explain to them what it means for a recording to live on Panopto. And lastly, add some language to your syllabus if you know for a fact that you're planning to record this semester that explains all of this for you, so you don't have to reiterate again and again. And we do have some built-in language around recording on the syllabus language page of our website. So those are my little pieces of advice. I think I'm throwing it over to Nick next, who's going to talk a little bit about the graphic design of any of the resources you end up recording.
Thank you, Carrie. Let me get my screen going. I believe everyone can see that now. Excellent. Okay. So real simple, just to start off, UMD and Smith generally have red, black, yellow, and white is technically one of our colors. These don't come default in PowerPoint. I'm not saying that whenever you guys are making your PowerPoint slides, you necessarily have to use these colors, but people often ask me what's the easiest way to be on brand, and my answer is going to be use these colors. Smith's colors are just a little bit darker, which I personally like because UMD's colors are a little more McDonald's for my taste. If you're in PowerPoint and you want to add a color, let's say here, fill, you can just hit fill or fill colors and it'll ask for these numbers, red, green, and blue. And we'll have these in the resources for you afterwards, so they're easy for you to find. If you're working in Google Slides, you'll want this number down here with all the letters in it instead. As for fonts, the school officially has Interstate and Bembo as our official fonts. We'll also have resources for you to download that. However, there are very close similarities between these. So you could use these that are built into Google Slides and PowerPoints. You can see they are very, very close. No one's really going to yell at you. It's kind of like you guys are making billboards on the side of the highway. So inside your class, these are perfectly fine. It makes the question on what font you should use very easy for you. This slide here, I know this is terrible, terrible to look at. I use it all the time because I worked for a company that wanted to use these colors as their official colors. This is terrible to read for anyone with normal eyesight. if you have a student with accessibility issues, this is going to be just absolutely impossible for anyone with even the slightest bit of color blindness. I don't know if anyone can even read the subtitle there. But the Smith colors work great. You can obviously put those on top of each other. Anytime you are, oh, I've lost the slide here. But anytime you are working with the colors with font on a background, different colors, you can use an online accessibility checker. It'll just run it through and make sure that most people with color blindness would still be able to read. In this case, yellow on black background works perfectly fine. A quick, easy way to kind of upgrade the look of your slides is going to be to just space out some of the text. Right up here, there's this little arrows pointed both ways. You can change things to double space, triple space, whatever, but you can see that this kind of spaces out everything. So those red lines are supposed to be connected. So instead, I can go to options below there. The default is that it adds some space before. We'll add some extra. And now that'll add some space between the bullets, but keep my lines together so they're much easier to read. And the reason I say that is because this is about 90% of what I get when people want me to make their PowerPoints look a little bit better. Way, way, way too much stuff on here. The title is not the most important thing on your slide. At least I hope it's not. If it is the most important thing, it should probably be the only thing on your slide. So what you want to do is break up your slides a little bit. You don't have to fit everything on one slide. Your title can be nice and small because that's not the most important part. Add some color to your text, some boldness, some spacing. That's going to make everything much easier to read. Squish everything over to the side a little bit. As long as your spacing is good here, you can make your chart nice and big and make that the focal point rather than squeezing everything onto one page. An important thing to do with PowerPoint templates whenever you use them is to use these placeholders. One of the worst things you could do is just add a random text box in here and type in some words, because then you have to go through, you have to change the colors and everything to what you want. Same with pictures here. If I add in a picture, there it goes. It'll just kind of throw it in there. This isn't going to be perfect, but we'll do it nice and quick. And then like I could move these around, and if I decide, oops, I've messed up my entire slide. If I right click, I can hit reset and it fixes everything for me. except for this text that I added beforehand. It stays. This picture, the first one that's in here, is not actually added in, right? It's just pasted on top. So you'll see when I move everything around, everything else goes back except that one original one. The other great thing about this is if you right click, you can go to your layout and you can pick a similar slide that might be in your template, and they'll automatically try to fix everything that's set up in those placeholders. But again, this first one wasn't placed in right, so that doesn't work. And you can see this text box that I put in here also didn't change. If you don't see a slide that you like in these templates, or let's say you have this, any item that you can't move, you can't get a hold of it, that means it's probably on the master slides. To get to that, you go to View, Slide Master, and then this is all of your template slides here. So if I go up to this top one, if I decide all of my titles should be red, I can change that, go back to normal view, and then when I go through, all of my titles are now automatically red throughout the entire document. Also, let's say I wanted to get rid of that logo. I can delete that, and now it's gone from my previous slides. All right, and then the last thing I would like to point out. So right now, this document has a whole bunch of big pictures at the end. So right now we're at 23 megabytes, which is way too big to email to anybody. And I'm sure you guys have run into that problem before. So the nice easy fix for this is if you click on any picture in here and go to picture format, you can compress pictures. And the big thing is make sure that apply only to this picture is unchecked. So it'll go through the whole document for you all at once. You have to pick one of these settings. Print is fine. You can bring it way down to web. They're both going to be about the same. If I hit OK, and then I save it, we'll go back here. Now we're down to 4 megabytes. So much, much smaller. Another feature in that, let's go change this back to here. And picture format, crop. So sometimes there is a bunch of extra picture hiding outside of the box that you can't see. So I can't see that, but that information is still there. So also in compressed pictures, it'll delete that cropped area because you don't need that information anymore. So it'll just cut it out for you and hopefully make it a little bit smaller. We got a lot smaller on that actually. So now we're less than a megabyte. Okay, and with that, I'm gonna hand it back to Teresa.
Sorry, I'm out of presenting practice. Now what we're going to do, thank you, Nick and Carrie. Those are both, I think, some really great tips. We're going to hand it off now to Suzanne to talk about Panopto and video, and also then Garrett will kind of expound a little bit on video best practices. All right, Suzanne, it is yours.
Thank you, Teresa. So we're going to go over Panopto in the classroom. I'm not going to really go over like how to use the actual classroom itself, but we're just usually going over how to just use Panopto if you haven't used Panopto before. So first thing what we're going to do is enable Panopto in your course. I'm not sure if it's enabled by default. If you don't see in your Canvas course a thing that says Panopto recording, then we can easily turn that on. And once we do that, we're going to enable auto captioning. So any video that goes in there will just automatically get captioned, especially it'll help with any of your students that require ADS accommodations. Then we're going to make sure all your settings in Panopto is correct so that you will produce a nice video so that your students can view. And then we'll also talk about uploading other videos that's not just Panopto. You can upload other videos you might have recorded like last year or even a year before. And then we'll embed it into your course. Another option is also, we can also add quiz question to your videos. So if you want them to watch it and then ask them a question to make sure they're understanding the content, you can embed those questions in there. And you can have them feed it into your gradebook if that's something that you want. So next, important thing about recording your classroom is to actually get familiar with the classroom. So since classes start in, I'll say a week, a little bit over a week, try to schedule time with classroom support to like see the room that you'll be teaching in. Because some different classrooms have different equipment, but most classrooms will definitely have a podium, a crash-on panel, which that will explain like how to control things. And you'll have at least two cameras, one in the front and one in the back. The one that you normally will use will be the one in the back because the camera will be recording the you and the board, just like in this picture. But if you want, you can also contact Smith IT and schedule someone from classroom support to come into your room and have everything set up for you. So I would really highly suggest that. So next, the correctional panel in each classroom will control what gets sent to your projector. So whether or not it's the classroom PC or your laptop, in case you want to use your laptop instead. It also controls the lights in the room. And the shade. So again, there's also a button that says call for assistance. You click on that and that will contact Master Control. So they will, if you get stuck and anything's broken, click on that, they will come over to your classroom and they'll fix whatever might be broken. But So again, if you schedule an appointment with Smith IT, they will come over ahead of time. And I put a link in the, we'll share the resource on the webpage to let them know when to come to your class. If you plan on using a classroom computer, make sure you bring in your slides or any documents you want to share with your class in a flash drive. The best thing, truthfully, is to just store everything on your cloud storage. So whether or not you use Box, Dropbox, even Google Drive, you can go use Kumo on the website, kumo.umd.edu. That will basically integrate, it'll connect all your cloud services. So then when you launch into your classroom, launch into the classroom computer, it will actually mount them as a letter drive. So you open Windows, File Explorer, you'll see like letter G for Google Drive or something. Then you open it just like a regular file. Again, schedule, very important. Schedule classroom support in advance so then they can come in and help you set up your cameras and everything. So next. Again, so the difference between using the classroom PC and using a laptop is that the classroom PC will have the room mics and cameras connected to them. So if you're planning to, if you want them to see the board that you're writing on, then it's best to use the classroom PC so then you can see the cameras. If you're not comfortable with using that, you rather prefer using your laptop, then you can do that. Just be aware that the cameras won't be able to come to your laptop. So you'll be using your laptop camera and the mics on the laptop. I've tried it before. The mic seems to be fine. You record it, but just make sure your laptop is facing where you want it to be. So if you want them to see you, then just have it face you. But most of the time, I think you might want to have them face the whiteboard that's behind you. So no matter which one you plan to use, there's basically six things you want to do for Panopto recording. So the first thing you want to do is launch a presentation. Just have everything ready that you want to share. Then you want to do is go to your Canvas site, open your browser, log into the course that you're teaching. And from there, go into your Panopto recording, and then there's a button that says launch Panopto and start recording. Your Panopto will launch, and what you want to do is check your cameras, whether or not it's the room cameras or the camera that's on your laptop. Next, check the mic. the mic's the most important thing, because otherwise they can't hear what you're saying. You can have the camera facing like the wall, it'll be fine, because they just want to watch your presentation and hear what you're saying. So make sure you check your microphone. And I can show you what to check after this slide. Then you want to check to make sure you're actually recording what you want to see. So if you're only wanting to report the whiteboard and you don't want to show your PowerPoint, then we're going to uncheck that. But if you want to record your PowerPoint, just make sure it's checked. So now what we're going to do is going to go over a demo. So let me share now. All right. So I have my first step is to launch my presentation. This is my presentation. Then I'm going to go to my Canvas course. So I'm going to teach in this course. Then I'm going to launch Panopto. So first thing I do is click create. Now the Panopto is already installed in the classroom, but if you want to use your own computer, laptop, you click create, Panopto for Windows, and you can download the Panopto recorder here. Once you download it, it's just a next install. Once it's installed, you come back here, click Panopto for Windows. So you do this either in your laptop or in the classroom. So you do open Panopto, it's just gonna confirm that that's what you wanna do. You say, okay. All right, so now there's an error because it wants to connect to a different camera. So I'm going to, if you're in the classroom, it should be default to whatever the classroom is. Right now, my computer has two different cameras. I'm going to use my webcam for this one. And then now we're going to check the audio. Camera's fine. I'm going to show my presentation back here. So now the audio. So you can see there's a meter. The audio is pretty low. I don't think this is the right one. So I'm going to change it to make sure it's the right camera. So I'm going to use my webcam mic. So see, now it's higher. So I lowered it, I'm going to increase it. But you want to make sure it goes up really high. Probably not to the red, but you know, either yellow or green, probably yellow. So now I know that they're listening. Oops, am I too high? So now I can check, I can hear, I can see that they can hear me. Quality should be high in the classroom. What you want to do high or ultra, because if you're planning to share like a spreadsheet that where the numbers are so small, having it high will allow them to see like the numbers clearer. And I can demonstrate later. So the next two is the sources. Main screen is basically what I want to share on my desktop. So if you're planning to share a PowerPoint or even like recording how to use a software, you want to capture the main screen. If you're just going to just do PowerPoint, then you can uncheck it. So then Panopto knows that I'm just going to capture just your slides. So I'm going to capture my main screen and my PowerPoint, because I'll probably share my slides later, my Excel sheet. So all you do, you'll see the folder. Folder should be the course that you're in. And then the name, default is gonna be when you started the recording. You can always change it, but we can change it later. So I'm just gonna start recording. So I'm gonna hit record. And then you can see the timer clicking and it's recording. So all I do, just like in class, I'll just start presenting my slide. All right, so I'm gonna slideshow. And say, welcome to my simple presentation tips, do and don'ts. And then I do like a slide. Here's my whiteboard. I'm drawing some stuff. Next slide, here are the colors. Here's yellow, another yellow, red, and then another red. Same thing, here are the fonts. And then I'm done. Let me see, there's chat. Okay. So. Let's say I'm done with my presentation, class is over. I'm gonna hit escape, come back here, and I just hit stop. Right, again, see the session name. I can leave like this so I remember when I did the recording. You can even change it if you want, so not the demo. And I hit done, right? It's just gonna start uploading everything, compressing everything, and just send it to your class. From here, you can just close everything down, log off, leave the classroom. And then it'll do this in the background. You don't have to worry about that, right? It takes a while, but as you can see, now I'm in my class. It's uploading, right? This is the one that might be done already. So we'll go ahead and look at this real quick.
And then you can see the timer clicking and it's recording. So all I do, just like in class, I'll just start presenting my slides.
I'm muted real quick. Right, so as you can see, I'm not sure if you guys can see it. This is what the students see, right? They see the room camera of what you're doing. And then your slides are right here on the side, right? And then they can go through and skip to like the certain part of the videos. If they want to go back, they can just skip there. There's thumbnails. What makes it helpful for them to like view what they want to what you're presenting. So I went out of place. So if you don't have Panopto recordings in your class, in your course, just go under settings, hit navigation, and Panoptos might be down here. All you do is select enable, and it comes up here, and just hit save. And then one thing you wanna do, I forgot to mention, once you enable it, you wanna click on the settings here. And then settings. And under caption, you want to change it to automatic machine captions. So you want to set this up probably now, and then you start doing your recording. So anything that comes in will automatically be captured. So I've had other videos before. You see all the sign that says CC, those are closed caption. So all the students have to do is come in. Sorry, I mute myself. And they hit the CC button down here. And then you can see the captions as they watch the video. Now, if you have other videos that you wanna drop in here, let's say I made one last year, you can easily click create, upload media, and then look for a video. So, oops, sorry. So I'm gonna upload this Zoom video that I did. I think when it's done, it should have a little green checkbox. All right, now it's processing. Same thing. Yeah, I wanna embed that. Yeah, I wanna use it, sorry. This was an accident. All right, so I'm done. And then you see is uploading and it's gonna close caption that video so then you can have them watch it. Does anyone have any questions or
yes? Yeah, just to clarify, Suzanne, a good step to do now or in the next day would be to go turn on captioning in Panopto, and then any choices you make after that, the captioning will do it for us.
Yes.
If you're following along, that's your only action item you can kind of try right now.
Okay, so this is the same thing with Zoom. So if you're planning to record Zoom meetings that you create under here, if you do cloud record to the cloud, it's gonna automatically dump into your Panopto recordings. So when it comes in here, same thing, it's gonna automatically caption your video. And so for example, this is one, it'll copy the meeting, when it started, everything. And you watch it like students can watch it like they would normally do as a Zoom video. Another thing you can do is also create quizzes. So let's say I want to create a quiz into this video. So when you hit edit, also one thing, you can hit edit and you can trim the video. So let's say I spent most of the time trying to set up my class. You can trim it by just moving this to the side. It'll just start right here instead. So let's say I'm going to trim this, hit apply, and it will just do the processing over and over again. I'm going to revert this because I'm going to trim it. But what I'm going to do is add quiz question. Yep, I'm going to discard. So on the side, there's a button that says quizzes. Here, what you want to do is go over to the area of where you want to add the quiz. So I want to start it from here. Let's see, let's do the font. So I want to add a quiz here. So what are the fonts you want? I see, can't remember.
Really quick, Suzanne, if anyone hasn't used in Panopto quizzing before, basically, if you assign any sort of asynchronous assignment, so you make a video you want them to watch, or even if you give them a reading you want them to read, and you assign no deliverable attached to that, it's very likely they may skip that assignment, right? They may skip that required reading. So our common phrase is, if you're going to assign, assess. So if you're assigning a watching, popping in one or two quick questions that they just get a point or two for is a great way to A, check the pulse of how many students completed it, and B, incentivize them to complete it. So that's why you might want to add an in-video quiz like Suzanne is demoing.
Yeah, right. So you can do multiple choice, true, false. So let's say I'm going to add this to this part of the video. So you hit type in your question, your answers, and then you hit add question. Right. Then we go to the, hit done, right? And then it's gonna ask you a question, do you want them to retake it? Or you want to block them because they need to answer this before going this. I'll just set the default. Then you go to the next part of the video. You can add more questions here. So I'm gonna add another question. There's right, same thing. So let's say I'm done. I'm gonna hit.
Yeah, colors.
Nope.
Yellow, red, and another red.
I love hearing the background, Suzanne. Double narrated there.
All right. So then when you start going through, the students start going through, they're gonna try to, they should hit the question, and it's gonna stop them and say, you know, which one do you want to say? If I say blue, just finish, and it's gonna say yes or no when I answer the question properly. So if let's say, first thing you do is create the, oh, that's what the video is.
Right. So as they're watching the video, it will interrupt them when it gets to a point where you laid a question.
Yes. So so there's two parts to that. One is to add enter the question. So let's say you want to actually grade them for it, because there's one where you want to just check to make sure they did it and know what's important. But if you want to actually grade them for it, then you have to actually create an assignment. So you go to assignment, and then you click plus assignment, video quiz, colors, and right. How many points? So I'm just gonna do a 5 point. So like I only had two questions and 5 points, so it will actually calculate properly. So if you got one right, but the other one wrong, it'll be 2.5. So we're gonna do submission type, which is external tool. And we're going to set it to Panopto recording. So let's see. of course, we have this on our website. So in case you missed this, you can always go back. And when I choose the quiz that we just made, so I made this one, I'm just hit insert, select, and then how many times, you know, due dates, and then I just save and publish. Right, so what students would do, they come to this assignment, and they'll see this. Oh, I think it's still processing, which is why it doesn't see the video. So let me see if I can find if I have another video. So same thing, students will, yes, well, I'll figure why that's doing it, but they're supposed to be able to hit play and then they see the recording. And then when they hit the question, it'll pop up and saying, let me take it, right? Continue, go to the next question. So, any questions? Sorry.
We've answered a handful of questions in the chat, but you can keep adding them in the chat or unmute and let us know. We can take this as a little question break.
Yeah.
Hey, Suzanne, it's Bill. So couple questions.
Yeah.
So again, I don't teach in the fall, so this will be my first time back in the classroom in a while. And so I have not used Panopto previously. So I'm in that large lecture hall, 1212, because there's a lot of students in the undergraduate. So it kind of looks like an auditorium. I'm up on a stage. I tend to wander around that stage. I don't really use the whiteboard, so it's just me and the slides that I'm using. Mm-hmm. Any tips in terms of what I should do with the camera? Because I'm not a stationary person from that perspective.
Are you planning to use your laptop or the room PC?
I'm going to use the room PC. Okay with that. So
yeah. So usually I would just have the room PC just display like the whole front area, which is usually the default. So then they can see you walking around back and forth. Yeah. Okay. Because the room cameras don't follow the faculty. So you have to just do a big overview of the front of the area.
Okay. That's fine. I mean, that'll work. And mm-hmm. as long as it's doing that, and the important thing are the slides and the PowerPoint.
Yeah, exactly.
So, okay. Second, I had three questions. Second one, student navigation, when they go to use Panopto, one of the features I liked in Zoom was that they could speed it up a little bit if they wanted to when they're watching it. And also, like you did, they could just drag the cursor and cut out the intro, cut out some Q&A at the end if they want. Is all that functionality still relatively the same in Panopto?
Yeah. Right, so when they watch it, they can
see the timer clicking.
Okay.
They have the same thing. So they go forward. And then, of course, they got stopped because they have to answer the question, right?
Okay.
But they can also speed it up right here under the 1x to like something faster or even slower. So they have the same thing.
All right, cool. Okay, that's fine. And then third and last question, I was kind of following what you're doing with the quizzes. I've always used LearningCat as the way that I delivered questions during the lecture.
Mm-hmm.
And what I started doing last year for asynchronous to allow them to watch this on their own schedule is instead of compressing the response time, the due date of the LearningCat exercise, I just basically opened it up for 72 hours. And I told them, so you can watch this lecture anytime over the next 3 days go in, use your own device and do that. And I'm assuming I can do the same thing right here. The lecture could be recorded in Panopto, but they could still respond to the exercise via Learning Cat.
Yeah. So like you can create this video like ahead of time, like either over the weekend or like now if you want. And then you can post it because it's just a regular assignment.
Yeah.
Right. So you have here where like when it's due. So I can have it due like the 31st and then submit it to them. I mean, and publish it to them. So then you can say, you know, go watch this video and it's due the 31st. So then when they hit save, it'll add it to their calendar because it's an assignment and they can see that they have until the 31st to complete the video.
Okay.
And you can absolutely marry any video that you assign as watching or any reading you give them with any other type of assignment you're used to giving. So it could be a traditional Canvas quiz, a short write-up, an essay, or what you said with Learning Cat.
Okay. Yeah. Using the Pearson tool and then it'll grade through there and just sync back to Canvas. So, okay. Got it. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So let's say I already created one of my, I want to import, let's say add my video into one of my weeks. So I click on edit, go to where I want to insert the video. So let's say I want them to watch on week 3, watch this video, right? So I go over here on this page. There's going to be a Panopto recording button that's green. Select that, and it's going to say which video do you want to use. So let's say I want to use the Turning Point example, right? And if you have videos in another course, you can actually hit the drop down and go into that other course. So let's see, I have my I'm going to go to my Pokemon course. I want to insert this video into my BMTD class. And then now it's here. I hit save. So then when they go to week 3, they can see it here and they just hit play. So this is not a quiz. It's just a video that I want them to watch. So they just come here, hit play.
Yes, it goes straight to the slide, so.
And that's it. So you can keep on adding more videos if you want throughout the rest of the year. Watch here, insert. And this is like another past recording. So does anyone else have any question? Otherwise we can hand it over to Garrett.
Thought I saw an unmute.
Suzanne?
Yes.
I have a question. This is Mary. And when I migrate my course, you know, to a new course and all the videos are there, I want to get rid of one of those videos, but I have a hard time deleting it. Do you understand what I'm on the home page?
Oh, okay.
You know, you would go down to like week 6 and there's a video that's been migrated from the previous course, but I want to use a different video now. How do I go about deleting that video that's been migrated?
All right, let me share again. So here's my video. You hit edit and then you wanna go over to that video. So let's say I'm gonna delete this one. Right, so you move your cursor to the end of the video. You should be able to just hit backspace, right? So I hit backspace, okay. Now the video's gone.
Oh, okay.
Right, and then now I just go back in here and look for the correct video that I wanna insert. This one.
I have tried everything, but not that.
it is kind of finicky in Canvas with the embedded videos.
Yeah. So yeah. Like back. Yep. And let's say if it's too big, you can always go in here. Mm-hmm. So under here, there's a video embed option, and you can make it smaller. So I want to make it like 500, no, 480 instead. Right. So insert now is a little bit smaller. You hit save. Mm-hmm. Now it's a little bit smaller and it's a different video.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Zen, I just have one question on what were the settings in Punapta recordings that you have currently? I mean, is there a way that, you know, if I record a video, I want it to only show up at a particular time? Is that something that I can set in Punapta to say, you know, I'm going to approve it?
Oh, yeah, yes. So, so when you go into your folder, whichever course it is, so you have to do all this in a, so each, if you have multiple courses, you have to do this in every single course. So,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. So under settings,
mm-hmm.
Loading. Okay. On the bottom, you can, you have different options. By default, is session will become available immediately. Mm-hmm. If you don't want that, you want to pause, you can set it to never, right? So then every time it comes in, it's not published until you want to publish it. So let's say I want to publish this because right now it says not available. Go into settings. Oops, sorry. And then all you do is change it to now. Right. So now when I hit, this should be saved already. Right. And now that not available to user isn't there anymore. So now students can start seeing it. So good if you have multiple section in one course space and you're mm-hmm. like, I want to wait until my 5 o'clock class is done before I let them see my videos. Then that's a good way to do it.
Got it. Thank you.
That's a good question. I forgot to mention that.
Can I quickly ask, you said if I have three sessions, do I just turn this and just say publish it the day of, or do you want, can I do it by section is what you just said, Suzanne, or?
Oh, no, you can only do it by like a certain time.
Okay, perfect. That's fine.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I think it's my turn to speak now. So I'm Garrett. I'm the digital media specialist. I'm kind of the guy in charge of video and recording and whatnot. So today I'm here, I'm gonna be kind of giving you some recording tips, mostly for like if you're recording at home. Some of them might also apply in the classroom. And then I was gonna go in and talk about some of the services we offer in the Smith School, like our One Button Studio and our actual media production studio, which is the big studio. So first of all, I wanted to start by saying there's already some good content out there covering good home recording techniques. One was put out by Tony Richards in Marcom. It's a really good video. A lot of what I'm going to do here today is kind of expanding on that or kind of elaborating on some of the things he says there. And we also put out an infographic that a lot of this is based on that has some sound advice for how to how to set up your home recordings to make it look good. So one of the first things I want to go over is what I think is probably one of the most important parts of video, and it's kind of echoing what Suzanne said earlier. It's not really the video itself, it's the audio. You want to sound good. And one of the big things about audio is like, it's not necessarily equipment that matters when you're recording, it's really where you are. Like, what is your environment like? What is your whole space, recording space is like, because that will color the sound. So if you're in a house with bare walls, you'll get a lot of reverb and a lot of echoey kind of effect. So what you can do is be in a house with a lot of furnishings, a lot of, if you have a room that has carpet, couches, upholstery, pillows and whatnot, I mean, those kinds of things all absorb that reverberation and makes it sound a lot better. Bookshelves are good. They're great for, they look good. They kind of give you a professional feel to your video. And they're also really good, dual purpose. They absorb sound as well. So the next thing that we can talk about is just proximity to the mic. You want to be close to the microphone, about ideally you want to be about a foot away. Because if you're really far away, if you're really far away from the microphone, you get to hear that echoey kind of overpower the primary voice. And so it just doesn't really sound that great. You just sound far away. So you want to be up close to the microphone. But a lot of what you guys are doing, you're going to be using like an internal microphone or a microphone built into the webcam. You're not going to have a lot of control over that. So it's kind of, you know, what you get is what you get. But what you can do is you can go out and get an external microphone. And what you want to do is be as close to that microphone as you can without having it in the frame. Unless you're okay with it being in the frame, because that's ultimately a subjective call. If you like that look, that's good. So one of the popular microphones out there is a desktop mic. It's like it's called a Blue Yeti mic. It's essentially a USB version of a microphone that looks kind of like this. That's one you would set on your desktop and speak, and it picks up really good. One problem with those microphones is they do tend to pick up a lot. So if you're in a noisier environment, or if you're in an echoey environment, it'll pick up more of that. Another style of microphone you can get that will get around that is a lavalier mic. That's something kind of like one of these things. This has a really big wind guard on it. Usually they come with a little foam piece on the end instead. And what you would do is you would just clip that onto your shirt or tuck that in your collar, or, you know, somehow have it, you know, close to your mouth, so you get really good quality audio without having a lot of the external noise interfering. I do recommend getting a USB style microphone if you get an external one, because they're kind of universal. They'll pretty much work with, you know, whether you've got an Apple or a Mac. And if you're doing Panopto recordings, you're going to be using your PC anyway. You're not going to be recording to an actual camera or a phone. Although even with a phone, you can get a USB adapter of sorts to try and, you know, something like this to make it work with your phone if you want to do phone recordings. The next big thing for audio is please do not use your Bluetooth headsets, your AirPods, to do recordings. If you do, your recordings will sound like this. I don't know if you guys can hear the audio difference because I'm not listening to this myself, but Bluetooth headsets degrade the audio a lot. And so, yeah, this is using my EarPods right here. And right now, I'll go ahead and switch back to my camera-mounted microphone, and hopefully that sounds better. Next thing I wanted to talk about was just do a quick overview on lighting. The standard setup for photography and video is it's called a three-point setup. It's where you have a key light that's kind of like your brightest light, and you'll have a fill light that kind of fills in the shadows from the key light, and the key light being like the brightest kind of primary light. And you'll also have a backlight. Usually the backlight is kind of there to kind of just put some highlights on your outline to kind of separate you from the background. It's not necessarily that crucial to have a backlight, but at least have a key light and the fill light. Normally I would be relying on a window over here to have a lot of natural light as my key light. And that would kind of like give me a lot brighter on one side than another. And that's just a way to kind of give visual interest, make you look better. So right now everything looks kind of flat because I've got that blocked out for me to do that little walk around trick I did earlier. And that's the other thing with natural light. You want to be leery. I mean, natural light works great if you have a nice picture window, if you've got something like that, that gives you a large light source that kind of gives you some soft light to work with. But you just want to be careful because a passing cloud can ruin your shot. A or ruin your lighting anyway. It can ruin, or, you know, an overcasty day can kind of make your videos look kind of dreary. And, you know, of course, you can't use it at night. So just things to keep in mind when using a window as your primary light source. One thing I'd mentioned there was like using it as a big light. You want to have bright, you know, bright lights, but to get like soft soft shadows without that harsh kind of like film noir look of just like really harsh shadows and good lighting. You want to use something that's kind of a larger light source. And what you do with that is you take you don't use a, I had one sitting over here. Yeah, don't use a just a raw bulb. Definitely have a shade or something over it to kind of make it a bigger light source. One thing I like to do, like in this room, I actually have all of the lights are pointed up at the ceiling. So that the ceiling acts as a reflector from and makes those makes the light a lot softer. One thing I also do is I'll use an art pad. It's a little too far. One of these art pads I've used before, I'll take a light, kind of something like one of these lights, just a book light, clamp light, and clamp in front of it, have the whole setup in front of me. And that way the lights diffuse and coming out, and it actually gives a nice soft lighting. So
we had a question in the chat, Garrett, about circle lights or ring lights.
I actually was going to get to that. So ring lights are nice. They do give a nice lighting. I kind of tend to avoid them because they're centered light. And so the sides of your face tend to be a little bit dark unless you have a secondary light somewhere. The other thing is they give you that circle glare in your eyes. So if you're looking at the camera, you've got this perfect circle in your eyes. It's a reflection of the light. And I always thought that gave everything kind of this sci-fi feel. So if you like that look, then, you know, go for it. I mean, I think that they're great, but otherwise I try to depend on more, you know, kind of traditional light sources. That was actually gonna be my next topic. Okay. One last thing I want to talk about with lighting is if you're using light bulbs, you want to make sure that you know what color temperature you're looking at. So light bulbs are usually, I mean, you've heard them referred to as like warm white or daylight. Warm white tends to be, I don't know if you guys can see the color change or not, but warm white tends to be kind of this yellowy hue that's considered like 2700. If you're looking for a number that they associate with it. Daylight tends to be a bluer hue. And that's about 50,000 Kelvin is what they call it, daylight. Essentially, that's all technical stuff you might not really care about that much. What you want to do is you want to just be consistent. Make sure that the bulbs that you buy are like in your lighting setup are about the same. And honestly, I recommend getting daylight bulbs if you're going to be using natural light as well, because they'll blend better. So that's my thoughts on lights. I wanted to do a quick overview on cameras, because I've had people ask me for like recommendations for buying cameras or, you know, buying webcams. Essentially, I think that pretty much all the webcams out there, if you've got a brand name one or you're built within one and your laptop's relatively recent, they'll work pretty good. There's a pretty big gap between, you know, getting a decent webcam, like price-wise, and then going the next step up, which is to buy HDMI conversion cards and SLR cameras and or GoPros or something like that. I mean, you're going to spend a lot on that. So I think that, you know, using a Logitech or Microsoft webcam is pretty decent. And then I wanted to give a quick overview on like composition and whatnot. Right now I'm doing just kind of a centered shot. You know, I'm right in the middle of the camera. Sometimes people for just for visual interest will do like a rule of thirds kind of thing. So I'm a third of the way through the frame. You know, I could stand over here as a, you know, on the other side, and that kind of gives people something else to look at, or something a little bit different to look at. So you know, I think if you want to keep interest in or in the camera view, just something to think about. I try to give a little bit of headroom up here, try not to have my head cut off if I can help it with the videos. And if you're going to do this rule of third thing, you know, it's good to either face the camera or face towards the emptier side of the frame. Because if you face over this way, it's just going to be nice and crowded and very awkward framing. Okay. So I think what I had next was just, just quick bits of advice. Be sure to test your equipment. Like if you're running your, you know, if you've got your own webcams, if you've got your own microphones, do a quick test recording, make sure that things are working before you do your recording, because nothing sucks more than doing a, you know, if you're doing a 10 minute recording or, you know, several recordings, and at the end of the day, you go to watch them and there is no audio, or the camera, the white balance of the camera was completely off, or something was weird, something weird. So I definitely encourage you to do a test and, you know, make sure things are working right before doing your actual recordings. When it comes to setting up your own little home studio recording space, I'd say experiment. A lot of the things that I'm telling you right now are things that I stumbled on or things that I just, you know, try it out to see if it would work, see if this works. I'm always changing things up to see like, what's the better way of doing this? Hey, how can I make this more interesting? And, you know, that's how, you know, just experimenting. And that's how you get more experience in, you know, figuring out what looks good in your videos, what you like. I guess at this point, I'm going to go on and talk about our offerings at the college, at the University of Maryland, or at the Smith School. So we it's not so recent at this point, but right before the pandemic, we put together the One Button Studio. We've got to it's pretty well refined kind of professional space that's meant to be kind of a self-serve. You go in there, that's green screen's already set up, lights are already set up, there's already good audio, the room is pretty well soundproofed. And it's just kind of set up for you to go in, record, and get a video and leave. Just be on your way. So the way this works is, I mean, you can go in, you bring in your PowerPoints on a flash drive or if you want to just bring in, if you have a laptop, or pretty much anything you can put on the display in the computer in the room, you can record and superimpose your image on it live. You can record yourself over a preloaded background. So we have a bunch of different backgrounds loaded on the computer that you can pick from to kind of, you know, if you just want like a talking, you know, just you talking to your audience kind of video, you can put your video as a smaller overlay over a PowerPoint, like in the bottom right corner, or over, like I said, your laptop or anything else you can bring up. It also can work with Panopto. There's if you wanted your video, the video section of the Panopto to be you over a custom background, you could do that. So Yeah, the way you would get into the One Button Studio is we have a Calendly link that you can schedule time in the studio. If you want to schedule time to record, or if you just want to tour, feel free to schedule time. That's part of a one-pager document that kind of describes more in detail of like what the One Button Studio can do. And we'll send that out after the webinar here. Feel free to come by. When you schedule that way, you'll have guaranteed support for your time in the studio. So someone will be on hand to help you with any technical problems or any issues you might stumble on, and make sure that the studio is warmed up and ready for you to use. Please definitely check that out. Next up, we have the Media Production Studio. This is for kind of our larger scale projects. So the idea is, this is a space where, if you want to record and you have you want really pristine, edited videos, you're not necessarily, you don't need them tomorrow, but you need them to look really good. You go, we'll set you up in the Media Production Studio. Some of the things we can do in the big studio is we have a professional teleprompter. So this way you can be looking at your script and looking at the camera at the same time. You don't have to worry about your eye line being way far off as you're trying to read your notes or your script. We also have done different styles of projects in there, interviews with multiple camera setups. So I don't know if anyone here, how many people saw the Teach Talks videos, but those are something that we filmed in the One Button Studio. We actually had three cameras set up during the interview on a green screen, and we subbed in a 3D modeled background to put them in a virtual kind of talk show set. So, there's a couple cool things you can do in there. One of the more interesting, unique things that we have going on in the studio is we have a light board. That's the middle picture there is me drawing on the light board the other day. So it kind of makes it look like when you're on the video, it kind of looks like you're writing in thin air. These kind of bright glowing letters, it's kind of like you can use it like a normal whiteboard, except for you don't ever have to turn your back to the camera. You don't ever have to turn, you don't turn around. You're looking at your audience while you're writing out what you want to, what you're trying to say. So those are all cool things that we can do in the bigger studio. If you want to schedule time in there, you can either fill out, we have a form for scheduling a consultation, or you can email us at otl-edtech@umd.edu. And so the process there is we'll schedule a consultation with you, figure out the scope of the project, figure out exactly what you're trying to do, what you're looking for, and what your timeline is, and we take it from there. That's normally how we work things, so. I think that's it for my spiel. Any questions? All right. I guess I'll go ahead and pass it on back to Teresa to take it from here.
Thank you, Garrett and Suzanne and Nick and Carrie and everyone. I know it's a lot of information. But we hope that, you'll find some helpful tips that we've given you. And again, Carrie, I'll send out all of the resources that we've talked about. And you can always reach out to us to schedule consultations. But I think we don't have anything else, Carrie, right? So if you all want to ask more questions or, anything like that, we are here for you and happy to chat a little bit. No?